See Brother Roberts back there. You want to come on up? You sure? All right. There's some people probably here tonight to hear you sing, the lead singing. And they're going to be disappointed if you don't come up here. Okay, let's go to 222. We'll do all three verses. I'll pick you up about 4:30. He said, okay. Well, about 4 o'clock, he called me. He said, brother, he said, you ain't going to come get us for church? I said, yeah. He said, it's almost 5 o'clock. And then he thought, wait a minute, I didn't turn my time back. Now, he was on time this morning. I don't know what happened.
I'm trying to make fun of you.
But anyway, let's turn to page 220. This will be our last congregation song. We got a couple of specials tonight, so
what number?
Just take her off from there, brother.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry.
Just go ahead and take her off.
Couple of ushers come up.
This is our love offering.
This is the love offering for the revival.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right, page 220, we're going to do the first and the third. Men's stripe. Go ahead.
Men's stripe are the wealth of this white man world. They seek after honor and fame. Forever she's sporting her diamonds and pearls. They put their dear silver to shame.
Thank you. Before we get started on this song, I want y'all to listen to the words of this song.
This is when the roll is called up young. And the words at the end of it, can you say, I'll be there? That's one thing you need to be for certain. When the roll is called up young, I'll be there. If you can't say that, I know we're going to have somebody come preach here in a few minutes. Today is the day of salvation. If you can't say that, you need to turn your life over to Jesus. All three of them.
Go. You're not hungry right now. Let's go to the Lord with a word of prayer. Lord, we come to you tonight, and we come, every single one of us, fully dependent on you. Lord, we live in a world that is broken. Lord, we live in a world where things are at times strained. And Lord, it is that reminder that this is not how it was meant to be, nor is it how it will always be. But in that intermediate time, Lord, as we learn to walk by your grace and your mercy and your love, Father, I pray that our hearts may be softened. Father, I pray that our spirits may be attentive and that your Holy Spirit may work as only He can. So, Father, now, I pray that you would move mightily tonight. Lord, work in a way that you alone will receive the glory. It's in Christ's name I pray. Amen. Well, good evening and welcome again to this gathering of Toledo Bend Bible Baptist Church. I am privileged to be here with you. And I'm going to begin with telling a little bit of a story about when I first moved to seminary in Fort Worth, Texas. I'll never forget the day that I was driving down Seminary Drive, where it intersects with I-35 West, and I look to my left and I see it. Heresy is what it is. It's a Sonic that's not a drive-in, but it's a drive and park and go inside. Isn't that just wrong? Sonic is America's drive-in, right? I mean, who goes and sits inside of a Sonic? What type of weirdos in the world are they? I knew it was going to be a long haul at that point. And they needed some good truth delivered to them. You know, we use that word heresy often. Maybe we don't, but we've heard it used. What really is heresy? Heresy is a belief or opinion that runs contrary to a widely accepted doctrine. It's not a disagreement about secondary or tertiary items, like the way that our church polity is set up. It's not about the type of music that we sing or the type of services we have or when we have those services. But truly, heresy is anything that strays from that core belief of the gospel. And tonight, that's really what our passage is addressing. It's addressing, as I told you I would title it, the homewreckers, the heretics, and the hypocrites. If you have your Bible, I want to invite you to turn with me to Titus. Titus chapter 1, and we'll be looking at verses 10 through 16. As you turn there, what we need to realize is that the challenges that we face today as a church are really nothing that are new or unprecedented, but rather they are recycled from heresies and challenges that the church has faced for rather the last 2,000 years. Just think about this. Adoptionism, a heresy that was condemned. It was actually advocated by a man in the second century of the church. His name was Theodotus. Theophilus is the guy who commissioned the writing of Luke and Acts. Theodotus is the one who put out adoptionism. And that's a belief that says that Jesus was merely a man and that he was born fully a man, no deity to him. And at his baptism, when the Spirit came down on him, at that point, God adopted him as his son, and thus he became the Messiah. That was condemned as a heresy in the second century, shortly after Theodotus proposed it to the church. That is the official doctrinal stance of the Jehovah's Witness Church. Modalism, a heresy that came about in the 4th century of the church. It was put out there by Sabellius. If you read theological literature, you'll see it talked about as Sabellianism. But here's what modalism is. It is a Trinitarian heresy. It was condemned as a heresy in that time period in which they said there is but one God, and He masquerades in different modes. So, when you have God the Father, there is no God the Son, and there is no God the Spirit. And when Jesus was on the earth, there was no God the Father in heaven, and there was no Spirit. And when God the Spirit comes into the presence, and it is in a believer's life, or is in the presence of a worship service, there is no Son at the right hand of the Father, there is no Father in heaven. That was rightly condemned as heretical in the 4th century. Yet that is the official doctrinal position of the United Pentecostal Church. You get a little uncomfortable now, aren't we? Because we're talking about people that we know. People that we love. Think about Gnosticism. From the very inception, even in Scripture, you see Paul writing to, say, for instance, the church at Galatia, calling out these Judaizers who were saying and proposing these things about mystical experiences. It's all throughout Galatians. It's all throughout Colossians. Gnosticism is a belief that said that which is spiritual is good, that which is flesh is bad. And so there was a result that we wanted to escape the reality of the physical And we wanted to be all in the spiritual. We wanted to experience this mystical nature. Yet isn't this how often we view Christianity? Or spiritual, truly spiritual experiences. Now don't get me wrong, if we truly do know Christ, if we truly have experienced the Holy Spirit, there's an experience there. There really is. But to go about seeking a religious experience is nothing new or nothing other than another form of Gnosticism packaged for the 21st century. So today's passage, or tonight's passage, is very relevant to us. Perhaps at this point you're offended, to which case, hang in there because I want to show you specifically in Scripture why this matters. Perhaps you think these are just trivial matters that only preachers talk about and they have no bearing on my life. Stick with me and look at the passage here in a moment. Or maybe at this point you're thinking, okay, I'll placate and we'll see where this goes. Just trust me. Stick with where we're going to be in Scripture tonight. So I want to ask you if you found your place in Titus chapter 1. Tonight's sermon will largely, actually all be from verses 10 through 16. But we're actually going to start reading in verse number 9, which we looked at this morning. And I'll explain why in just a moment. So if you found your place, follow along with me as we read Titus chapter 1, starting in verse number 9. And this is speaking to what an elder is to do. Holding fast the faithful word as he has been taught, that he may be able by sound doctrine both to exhort and to convince the gainsayers. For there are many unruly and vain talkers, deceivers, especially they of the circumcision, whose mouth must be stopped, who subvert whole houses, teaching things which they ought not for filthy lucre's sake. One of themselves, even a prophet of their own, said, "The Cretans are always liars, evil beasts, slow bellies. This witness is true. Wherefore, rebuke them sharply, that they may be sound in the faith, not giving heed to Jewish fables and commandments of men that turn from the truth. Unto the pure all things are pure. But unto them that are defiled and unbelieving is nothing pure, but even their mind and their conscience is defiled. They profess that they know God, but in works they deny Him, being abominable and disobedient, and unto every good work reprobate." In a nutshell, what we find in our passage tonight is, since false teaching wreaks havoc in our churches and lives, we must correct it with truth and live in God's grace. Church, I want you to look around tonight and I want to ask you to answer the question, do you want to see havoc wrecked in your church? No. Do you want to see havoc wrecked in your lives or in the lives of those whom you love? I would hope you answer no. So this passage is very relevant for you and for me and for today. The first thing that we see in the passage is we see the picture of the home wrecker. We see that verses 10 through 11. Now maybe you're sitting there wondering why we started in verse number 9 rather in verse number 10, since that was going to be the context of our passage tonight. Well, I call these at my church preacher pointers. They're things I say just to kind of help us learn how to better read Scripture. What is the first word? Now, for those who weren't here, I really do expect a response back, okay? So what is the first word that you see in verse number 10? Four. All right, so several of y'all can read, several of y'all we're not sure about right now. When you see the word "for" in Scripture, it's showing that this is a subordinate sentence. In other words, it is further explaining something which has been said. It doesn't stand on its own. So at the very end in verse number 9, as Paul is writing to Titus about setting in order that which remains and appointing elders in every town, and he talks about how they are to be well qualified in how they treat their family and well qualified in how they treat their friends, and ultimately they are to preserve the faith. That's verse number 9. He's going on in verse number 10 and say, this is important for the reason there are people out there who are home wreckers. And I don't mean that in the sense of your personal home, but the house of the church. They are here to wreck the faith. Look at verse number 10. For there are many unruly and vain talkers and deceivers, especially they of the circumcision. We need to be very sure and very careful to know that there are many who would seek to derail the faith. Satan is not stupid. There's a lot of things in which the devil is, but one of which is he is not stupid. Scripture tells us that he is cunning. That he is like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. So you better be absolute certain that any time that the Lord starts to work, any time the Lord starts to move, one of the tactics that Satan is going to have is to trick someone, one of those many, to come in and to wreak havoc in the family of the faith. Sometimes and often it will happen in the form of those who are disunifying over things that have no eternal consequence. And if Satan can't get it one way, he's like a well-tooled fisherman who knows exactly how to clip his bait from the line of that temptation and swap out something else and keep throwing it out there until he can hook, line, and sinker us. We need to be very careful to realize that there are those who are out there, and we need to be aware of it. Because if we're not, we will lose track of where we're supposed to be going and what we're supposed to be doing. We'll get distracted on things that really don't matter. My youngest daughter, her name is Maddie. Maddie is 8 years old. And bless her heart, she lives in her own world. You can tell Maddie that she needs to go brush her hair and put her socks and shoes on. And 15 minutes later, Maddie is in her room with an art project and everything strewed all over the room. She just can't do it. She cannot focus from point A to point B because she just gets distracted. But isn't that how we often are as Christians? Instead of focusing on the thing, there are the many who are unruly. One of the markers of that type of home wrecker is someone who is insubordinate. That's maybe another way that you can translate that word unruly, someone who is insubordinate. And I can say in my tenure in pastoral ministry, I can generally spot those pretty quickly who are going to be those who are divisive in church, especially even those among pastors, and I'm sure Brother Bill has met them. They are insubordinate. They don't want to answer to anyone. They want to be the boss. Beware of those type of people. More so than that, they are insubordinate to the Word of God. We must structure our lives. We must structure our church. We must structure our Christian living not on our traditions, though as well as they may be, not on our opinions, though as well-formed as they may be. The only thing that is worthy of our devotion is to structure our lives and to submit them to the Word of God. You see, as he goes on, he talks about they are those who are vain talkers. They are empty talkers. They are windbags. One of the ways that you can spot that is when someone stands in a pulpit, whether that's in person, whether that's on something you're watching, or maybe you're just listening to, and they say, all right, I want to talk to you about, and maybe they read a scripture, maybe they don't, but then they read the scripture, and the rest of the time, there is no reference back to scripture. Because at that point, what you have just heard is a hobby horse speech rather than a sermon. We don't need other people's opinions. We don't need those who are going to vainly talk of things that don't matter. We need the Word. We need to be fed the Word. There are those who deceive. Ultimately, there are those who manipulate. As you read in verse number 10, look back with me. especially they of the circumcision. Now, Paul was not an anti-Semite. He was not against the Jewish religion, as some have pitted him in biographies and writings on Paul. But what he was against was legalism. And in this time period, there were those who were of the Judaizers, as they're called in other places, who said, in order to be a good Christian, you must be circumcised. Last time I checked, there was a whole council that was on this in Acts chapter 15, in which they decided that no, Christians don't need to be circumcised in order to truly be Christians, because as Paul said in Galatians 3, circumcision is not of the flesh, but it is of the heart. There were those who said, no, to be a good Christian, you must be like the Jews and you must keep the Sabbaths and the festivals, to which Paul writes to the church in Colossae, to which he says, let no one judge you according to the Sabbath. So according to the festivals, these were a shadow of the things that are to come. Now, while we as a church here in the 21st century, Anacoka, Hornbeck, Toro, probably don't have a whole lot of Judaizers around us, one thing we've got to be careful of is legalism. Because in every context, in every human heart, we love legalism. We do. You can think that you don't. You can think that I like grace. But if we really are honest with ourselves, we like legalism because it gives us a sense of control. That if we do X, Y, and Z, then we will be acceptable to God. We will be more holy to God. We will be pleasing to God. Guess what? God's love cannot be bought with your action. God's love is unconditional because of the blood of Christ. These homewreckers came in and they manipulated people by telling them that they had to be circumcised. And Paul tells them the response that you should have in verse number 11, whose mouths must be stopped. Why? Because they subvert whole houses, teaching things that are not for filthy lucre's sake. They're hirelings. One of the things that I'll say it does bother me when I think about this passage is, if you've ever known any who have been taken in by the homewrecker, to say, when I graduated and left here, I attended Louisiana College. And at the time that I started college, I really didn't know a whole lot about Louisiana College other than it was a Baptist college. And my first year at college, I had a few professors who should not have been professors, and certainly not professors at a Christian college. I had one professor who did not believe in the inspiration of Scripture at all. Rather, he believed that all of these were myths that were made up. He did not believe in the penal substitutionary atonement of Christ on the cross. He did believe Jesus was a real person, but he was just a man who left a good example, and his death on the cross was nothing more than an example of sacrificial love for others. Had a philosophy professor who did not believe that ethics were something that were solid, but rather were fluctuating depending on your own take on things. There was no black and white and everything was gray. When I started at Louisiana College, there on the third floor of Tudor Hall, there were a group of us who all came in really going toward that idea of vocational ministry. Of the six of us that I can just think off the top of my head that were kind of on that path, three of us still serve in vocational ministry. And three, after that first year, completely abandon the faith. Now, I praise God that, number one, I had a foundation because of a church that taught truth and taught the Word and taught me to think through the Word. I also thank the Lord that my second year of college, they hired a new dean over the Department of Religion, and he came in and cleaned house and got rid of those who should have never been there. And for the next 3 years, I had personal discipleship and mentorship, not just walking through the things of the faith, but showing me what it could be like and how you can think well as a Christian. But I'm here to tell you, it is real. And it's not just at a school of higher education that it is real. Parents and grandparents and uncles and aunts, if you don't know, right now social media is being utilized and being weaponized, not just as some way that you can entertain yourself, but worldviews are being pushed through that over and over again. And the stuff that our students are being encountered and assaulted by is something that we can't even imagine. So we need to be very careful, and we need to pray fervently. We need to pray faithfully. It's not just the homewrecker that he talks about here. In verses 12 through 14, he moves to the different category, the heretic. Look at verses 12 through 14. One of themselves, even a prophet. This is actually a quote from Epimenides, who wrote in the 6th century B.C., said, "Cretans are always liars, either beasts, slow bellies." To which Paul says, okay, we'll concede that is true. The point that he's trying to make is, even your own people who are criticizing you, sometimes they get something right. "Wherefore, rebuke them sharply, that they may be of the sound faith." With those who are practicing heresy, we are to rebuke them, and not just throw them out, but also to teach them sound faith. Now, in verse number 14, he talks about not giving heed to Jewish fables and the commandments of men that turn truth, that turn from the truth. In this time period of Christianity, the Jewish culture were like super spiritual. Y'all have heard about the Pharisees and the Sadducees. There was another group called the Essenes. They largely wrote the Dead Sea Scrolls, and they were kind of a weird group out by themselves anyway. But, you know, we often are very critical of the Pharisees. These were the legalists. And we're very critical of the Sadducees because these were the ones who had synchronically jumped in bed with the Romans, thinking that this was the way to power. But, I mean, these were people who truly, maybe sometimes for the wrong motivation, wanted to seek the Lord. And to seek the Lord, they had a solution. The laws of the Old Testament, 613 of them, were not enough. So, aha, what we're going to do is we're going to develop another document that explains those laws even further. So, for instance, remember the Sabbath and keep it holy. Well, what does it mean to not work on the Sabbath? Well, a spoon or an eating utensil is kind of like a shovel. So if you're eating with a spoon on the Sabbath, that is considered work. Therefore, the solution is to limit the amount of food that you can put on a spoon as the size of half of an olive. Pretty simple, right? Oh, to remember the Sabbath, keep it holy, you also had a certain number of steps that you could walk in a day. If you walked over those amount of steps, then you were considered to be working. Well, how in the world am I supposed to get to the synagogue if I live beyond the amount of steps that are available to me to use in the daytime? I've got a solution. I will build a shed, or as many sheds, between here and the synagogue so that every time I enter my shed, my steps recount. And I can start over again. It's not considered work. I mean, this was the system that these Judaizers were trying to push on the church. It was a system that was rife with traditions. And they were well-intending traditions. Brothers and sisters, I want us to be very careful to not elevate our traditions to the same level as Scripture. Our traditions may be good. They may be appropriate, they may be fitting, they may be very honoring. But they are not Scripture. And we must be careful to not apply that universally to every church everywhere. Because again, what are they to do? They are to rebuke false doctrine and teach sound faith. They're to teach the truth. Look at verse number 14. Not giving heed to the Jewish fables and commandments of men that turn from the truth. Again, where can we know truth from? From God's Word. From Scripture. Ultimately, the truth is embodied in the gospel of Jesus Christ. I told y'all in every sermon that you're going to hear me preach, whether here or anywhere else, you will hear me present the gospel. So, tune your ears open, even if you're already a believer, because the gospel is something we need to hear, not just as a lost person needing to be saved, but we need the gospel every single day as a Christian. Amen. Four words, God, man, Jesus, response. There's a God who is holy, who is right, who made every single one of us. I want you to know that if you're here, there is something that is unique about you because you are created in the image of God. You are created to know God. But there's a problem. We, as His created beings, sin. Sin isn't just a missing of the mark. Sin is if we are turning and shooting our arrow in the opposite direction of what God wants us to do. It is rebellion. It's sedition. And because of our rebellion against the Creator of the universe, we are separated in relationship and we are destined to hell for all of eternity. That's a problem. But Christ. God so loved us in that while we were sinners, He sent His Son. And this isn't just a New Testament concept. Right after the fall in Genesis 3:15, as God was cursing the serpent, He said that one day the seed of the woman will come and crush the serpent's head. We see as Noah had this second shot at things, there's this reiteration that God will one day redeem His people. And Noah's not the one who could do it. When Moses came and he gave the people the law, it wasn't enough just that they had the law, because we've already heard they wanted to add more law and more law and more law, because the law was never intended for us to be good enough for God. The law was there to teach us that we needed more. We didn't need kings as the people thought they did. We didn't need judges as the people thought they did. We didn't need prophets as the people thought they did. Ultimately, we needed God to come and to live the life that we could not live, to die for us, so that through His death, we could be made clean. But for us to know that, we must respond. We must respond with faith and repentance. Faith says that I trust that Jesus' sacrifice is enough for whatever sin that I have committed in the past. And repentance says that because He is my Savior, He is my Lord, and I am turning from my pursuit of the things of the world, and I am turning to Christ. Friend, if you're here and you have never trusted in Christ, that is the truth that you need to hear. The only truth that will keep you from the heretics and the homewreckers and ultimately the hypocrites. That, brothers and sisters, that's the same truth that I need every single day, and it's the same truth that you need every single day. We need that truth that God so loved us that He sent His Son, and we can trust Him no matter the circumstance and no matter how bad it gets. We need that truth as we are tempted with sin, that His sacrifice is enough, that our hope is enough, and we can repent of our sin and trust in Him. Brothers and sisters, we need to preach the gospel to ourselves often. We need to preach it and remind one another of it every single day, so that we ultimately don't fall into the last category of the hypocrite. There's this saying that said at the beginning, verse number 15, "Unto the pure all things are pure, and unto them that are defiled and unbelieving is nothing pure. But even their mind and conscience is defiled." So what does that look like? They profess that they know God, but in works they deny Him. Practical atheism is what it is. You can say that you know God. You can say that you have experienced the blood of Christ. But if your life does not reflect it, it's practical atheism. It's hypocrisy. It's sedition. It's dangerous. What does this look like? They're being abominable, which is another way that they are just seeking the things that are not of the Lord. They are disobedient, that they will not be persuaded. And unto every good work, reprobate. I like the way that the Greek says right here. It uses actually a metallurgic term, that it is unfit. It's the concept that they have been proofed in the fire of reproof, and instead of finding pure metal and finding what they thought was there, it was only fool's gold. It was dross. Can I ask you to ask yourself tonight, do any of these fall into the category where you are? Because if we're honest, if we really are truthful about ourselves, sometimes they do, don't they? But here's the good news. I'm going to go ahead and jump to it because it'll be a few nights before we get there. Look at Titus chapter 3. Starting verse number 3. I'm just going to read verse 3 and 4. For we ourselves also were sometimes foolish, disobedient, deceived, serving divers lusts and pleasures, living in malice and envy, hateful, and hating one another. That's what we used to be. But look at verse number 4. But after that, the kindness and love of God our Savior toward man appeared, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to His mercy, He saved us by the washing of regeneration and the renewing of the Holy Ghost. There is hope. There's hope for every single one of us who are here today. And maybe that's exactly what you and I need to hear and need to be reminded of. God's grace is sufficient for everyday life. It's sufficient in the way that we order our life, as we looked at this morning. It's sufficient in the way that we live our lives and are protected against those who would come and snatch us from the faith and tempt us to be drawn from the faith. But it starts with us being cognizant of what Satan's schemes are, of knowing what the truth is so that we will not be deceived, and ultimately relying on His mercy as the Holy Spirit applies to our heart. Is that what you need to do tonight? Let's pray. Father, we